This is Dr. Rich Shuttler with How to Write Chapter 4, Lesson Number 8. This is the first of a three-part series on how you should consider presenting quantitative data in Chapter 4. As you can see in the lesson strategy, Lesson Number 8 will be followed by Lesson 9 and 10, which are Parts 2 and 3 of presenting quantitative data. Then I will finalize this entire chapter series with two final lessons, one on how to write a great introduction and conclusion sections for your chapter 4 in your dissertation, and then a wrap-up lesson for the entire program on how to present data in chapter 4. In this lesson, I'll address general information for presenting quantitative data in chapter 4, and then I'll provide some specialized information in the other two lessons in this strategy for quantitative data. And this lesson I'll conclude with a reflective summary, as I always do. In particular, starting out with general information for presenting quantitative data in Chapter 4 is explain how the data was collected. Simply give the reader a paragraph, two at the most, an understanding of how the data was collected. You more than likely had Likert-type surveys that you had distributed. How did you distribute that? Did you use SurveyMonkey.com? Did you use some other online method for that? Perhaps you did it on paper. And how was it distributed on paper? For example, in my dissertation, I was working in a corporate organization, and there were 800 people, roughly, that I had to send my survey to. And they did not have email at this time. This was quite a few years ago. What I did is I put a copy on paper of the survey into what was known as a guard envelope. And through the company mail system, I was able to distribute paper surveys to everybody. And that's how they returned the data back to me. They opened up that guard mail envelope, they got the survey, they filled it out, and they returned it. So explain how your data was collected. Then also, in another paragraph or two, explain how the data was processed. What that means in particular is, did you use SPSS? Did you use an Excel file? Or did you do it perhaps manually by using a formula and a calculator? Help the reader understand how you process the information so that in the future, should they want to replicate your study, they'll know exactly how you did your work. Keep in mind, as with explaining how the data was collected, not everybody's going to read your entire dissertation once it's published. Now granted, as you're working on your dissertation, of course your committee members and your university reviewers are going to read your entire document, but let's consider those who are going to read your work 2, 3, 10 years from now, and they want to find value in your work. They may not want to read, and they may not read Chapter 3 to get information. So let's give them a little information, the salient points, the highlights of how the data was collected and processed. Also give the context that the data was obtained. Perhaps you had to go through several rounds. For example, some of my mentees don't get enough surveys returned on the first round, so they have to open it up again, or they have to open it up through a snowball sampling because purposeful sampling was not done to the extent to get enough surveys returned. Keep in mind the context and how this was done. Help the reader also understand, perhaps, if you had the survey available for perhaps 5 days, 7 days, or 10 days in SurveyMonkey.com, so that we can get a sense of the scope of your data collection method and how everything was obtained. Explain how the data is being presented in your chapter. This is a great way to end perhaps the first section that follows the pilot study, because you've given some information about how the data was collected. You've given the context of it. Now, help the reader to understand, as they continue to read your Chapter 4, how the material is going to be presented. Just like in Chapter 4, for those who are doing a qualitative study, we want to give the reader a sense for the design of the chapter from this point till the end of the chapter, and that way the reader is aware of what's going to follow. Stay consistent in the design of your Chapter 4 as you're presenting the data. I have my mentees consider developing their input by research question, and then there's a narrative. A narrative describing the information about the research question, presenting the research question, any supporting information that needs to be known about the data collection and the data processing, then a table and figure that presents the data, perhaps the formula, and then another narrative that answers how the hypothesis was tested. I always encourage my mentees, as they close out each research question in Chapter 4, to end it with the testing of the null hypothesis to indicate whether that hypothesis was rejected or failed to be rejected. But stay consistent, and however you design for research question number 1, duplicate the same approach, the same process, the same formatting from narrative to table or figure and narrative for the next one. Stay consistent relating to each research question. Keep in mind, the readers of your work will like to see consistency. We're looking at how your work flows. This is an important point that often is missed on dissertations that are not approved on the first time. That, believe it or not, even if there's 3 independent variables with 3 research questions and 3 null hypotheses that we're testing, it's not uncommon that early drafts of dissertations are designed in a manner that's inconsistent. The same information may be provided for each of the research questions and the independent variables and the null hypothesis testing, but it won't be in the same flow and same format. This is important. This will help your work to get improved sooner. Highlight any results not expected. More times than not, we as researchers do research on that hypothesis, that educated guess. But there are times, and this is the value of doing your research, is that you may find something that was not expected. And that may mean more than just testing of the null hypothesis. You may find something that was unexpected, and I encourage you to highlight that in your chapter. This may be the most important piece of information. Even if it doesn't seem the most critical, make sure you bring it to the attention of the reader and have a discussion with your dissertation chair on what's the best way to present this. It may be that it actually needs its own heading about highlighting unexpected results. Explain your information in simple research terminology. Now, I know it can get complex when you're testing different types of formulas, whether you're going to do a chi-square test or a t-test, and you have to allude to all the information that's in the formula and how you're going to get the quotient. Keep in mind, in that case, use simple mathematical terms. As you reject the null or fail to reject the null, stay consistent with research terminology. If you're not sure still about research terminology, I encourage you, review a couple other dissertations that had the same research method and design. Look at how your university had those dissertations designed. Learn from those who have gone before you. Emulate the best writing styles and the flow of information, and stay simple in your research terminology. Stay accurate. Stay consistent with using the right research vocabulary in the context of the words and phrases, but keep it simple. You don't have to make this a complex document. Basically, anybody with an understanding of mathematics should be able to understand, by looking at your formula that you're going to provide, how the outcome was achieved. I believe in tables and figures to add value, as you probably already know by listening to any of the lessons in this program that I provide. Now, some dissertation chairs and some universities are not overly keen on tables and figures, but in Chapter 4, I believe it's a great opportunity to put the formulas in figures. As I'll talk in one of the other lessons that follows this, I encourage my mentees to provide the general formula and cite where that formula was taken from, then put their work into that formula, their numbers that they have based on their research, and then provide the answer. In that case, because the original formula is being provided, then the formula with the numbers are being provided, those are 2 different formulas. Thus, you have 2 different figures. You will more than likely have tables to present your data in Chapter 4 as well. Take a look and find perhaps the dissertations of the year that your university provides for, and or just look at good research reports and look and see how can you add more value with tables and figures in your Chapter 4. I'm not advocating just put tables and figures in there just to put them in there to take up space. That's not what I'm suggesting. but all too often students don't look and ask how could they add more value in their work. This is a great time for you to ask this of yourself and your committee members. Provide enough evidence to suggest findings. And what I mean by this is, as you provide in Chapter 4 the results of testing the null hypothesis, make sure in that narrative and in the mathematical calculations that somebody can get enough evidence to see the findings. Don't just tell us that the statistical testing produced a rejection of the null or failed to reject the null. Make sure there's enough evidence there that somebody can see how that naturally occurred. Don't worry about cutting to the chase, but at the same time, you probably don't need more than a couple paragraphs. As you'll see in the examples that I provide in quantitative information presented in Chapter 4, oftentimes a research question being presented in Chapter 4 is no more than a page long. Remember, as you're working in Chapter 4, you have to keep in mind, it's not about analyzing, it's just presenting the data. You will provide the analysis later in Chapter 5, but even in Chapter 4, where you're doing the mathematical calculations and you're providing whether the null hypothesis was rejected or failed to be rejected, you end it at that point. Chapter 5 will give the opportunity to indicate what that means in regards to answering the research question that's related to that null hypothesis, and what it means in regards to recommendations, what it infers beyond the survey population that you worked with, and any conclusions that you have. That's the analysis in Chapter 5. In Chapter 4, we just present the data and information. Other than citing formulas, and I do encourage you to cite formulas when you use a formula for a t-test, for example, where did you get that formula? Make sure as you present that t-test for the first time that you indicate in a citation, give credit where credit's due, of course, where that came from. So in case somebody wants to replicate your study, maybe they have a different source and they show that something's a little bit different in a t-test. That's possible. One publication could be wrong. Somebody else may have a mistake. So what you want to do is give that and cite that. But other than that, I can't see any reason to cite in Chapter 4, because after all you're doing is presenting the data. You already collect the data. In a quantitative study, there's no reason to quote individual survey participants like is common in qualitative research data being presented in Chapter 4. So don't feel like you need to cite a lot of information in Chapter 4. As part of the reflective summary for this lesson, you know, I was able to start out this three-part series by giving you some general information for presenting quantitative data in Chapter 4. In the follow-on lesson in this series, which is three parts about presenting quantitative information, I'll give you a couple examples on how my mentees had done their work and how they were able to accomplish getting their dissertations approved. And one of my students had Dissertation of the Year awarded to him for the fine level of breadth and depth they had throughout his entire dissertation, but I believe in particular Chapter 4, how well he presented this information, and you can learn from that. Now is a great time to ask your dissertation chair for ideas on how you can add more value. Speak with your dissertation chair, perhaps after your committee members review your Chapter 4. Ask this question of all your committee members: how can you add more value to your Chapter 4? I'm pretty sure every one of your committee members has something to contribute to you for you to consider how you can add more value. And I'll tell you what my experience is with this, that adding more value takes very little time but produces so much. And always keep in mind that while your immediate focus is to get your dissertation chair and committee members to approve your work so you can get it to university level so they'll approve your work, keep in mind, how can you add value to the unknowable reader 6 months, 12 months, 2 years, 10 years from now, so when they go inside your work and want to learn from you and what you did, that they'll find value in the work, it'll bring great credit upon yourself, your committee members, and your university. I wish you continued success. Continue on in this lesson strategy and learn even more.